Hi, budding engineers. Welcome to the structuring lectures and welcome to the new playlist on limit state design of steel structures, right? Conforming to Indian standards IS 800 2007, which is the Indian standard code, general construction in steel code of practice, and as well as conforming to SP 61 1964, which is also Indian standard code on handbook for structural engineers, structural steel sections. Now, in this class, we shall see why steel structures are needed and what are the advantages and disadvantages of the steel structures compared to that of the other materials, and what are the loads and load combinations if possible, right? Now, let us move to the discussion, student, that is of the steel structures, limit state design of steel structures. This is just now we have seen the these two codes, IS 800 2007 as well as the SP1 IS handbook number 1, properties of structural steel for rolled steel sections, steel tables, right? These two we shall be referring continually throughout the discussions, right? Now let us see why the steel structures are needed, what are the advantages, right? Now if we take an RCC structure, right, as the span increases, the section becomes very, very bulkier and very, very massive sections, right? That is how the depth goes on increasing. However, from aesthetic point of view, if the sections are bulkier like this, then we don't have the aesthetic look for them. Therefore, in such a case, from functional point of view, we'll try to limit the sectional dimensions. That is not acceptable from aesthetic point of view. Therefore, these RCC structures are generally economically used in the spans of the 10 to 12 meters or even 15 to 20 meters at upper bound value, right, using flat slabs, etc., right? However, if more spans are needed, then there is no other option but to go with steel as a material. Hence, steel structures are used, right? Now, whereas for industrial buildings, generally the bay spans will not be less than, say, 8 to 9 meters, at least not less than, and more spans, right? Therefore, there for such industrial buildings, we cannot have RCC as a material. And even sometimes the pre-stressed concrete material may be used, right, for a spans varying from 15 to 30 or 35 meters upper bound value, and beyond 30 to 35 meters, even pre-stressed concrete sections are also not economical. They cannot be used, right? Therefore, there is no other option but to go for the steel designs or steel structures, right? That is all. Now, starting from even as small as 1 meter to 30 meters, even we can design the sections using steel, right? And even if we have the spans even 30 or more than 30 up to 45 meters, even we can propose the steel girders, right? And even if I have the spans even more than 30 to even up to 120 meters, then also we can use steel trusses. And even if you have the spans even more than 120 meters, then I may use these steel sections along with that of the RCC, referred to as composite sections, right? Even for spans 50 to 250 meters or more, right? Now let us see the examples of these steel sections where these can be used. Now this is of the student. This is a 300 meter single lane steel cable suspension bridge, which is referred to as Bawang Bridge across the Siang River in Arunachal Pradesh, which is open to public in 2019. We can see here that the cable suspenders are there, which are suspended from a massive tendon here, right? Steel tendon, which are under tension. Even these steel suspenders, which are used to support the truss, steel truss here, right, are also under tension, right? Both this cable as well as this steel suspenders are under tension, right? And this entire cable is supported on two pylons at the ends of the river bank, right? And this is how another bridge of 360 meter, which is a deck type truss bridge. We can see a truss, right? Deck type truss bridge, which is used for highway traffic on Manali Leh Highway NH3, right? This is referred to as a Barsi bridge, which is constructed across Chenab River or Chandrabhaga River, right? We can see that there are six spans, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, approximately each span is 60 meters, right? This is a deck type, wherein we can see that decking is there on the top of the truss. Even we can see here old bridge here, right? And this is how our 435 meter cable stayed extra dosed bridge constructed on Durgam Cheruvu and Hyderabad and commissioned in 2020, right? Or another schematic view of the same, right? Across the Durgam Cheruvu and Hyderabad cable stayed extra dosed bridge, right? Another view, right? This is how the pylon, right, from where we do have the cable stays, approximately 56 stays, cable stays are used in this project, right? Even on the other side of the river, we do have another pylon, right? From both the cable stays are connected to the decking. Now let us see that another view of the same project, right? Whereas during construction, we can see that the decking, which is a pre-stressed blocks, right? The precast blocks, which are pre-stressed, right? Even we do have the pre-stressing here, right? Which are connected by means of the pre-stressing tandems, right? That is how they are connected one with the other. And in turn, even we can see that we do have from the pylon, the cable stays are also supporting the structure. This is during the execution, students, which is 435 meter long. Now we'll see another example where this is Bandra Varli Sea Link, which is 5.6 kilometer bridge, cable stayed bridge. Even the central part is the cable stayed bridge. Even others are just normal decking bridges. This is there in Mumbai, right? This is one view, and also another view in the night, right? Another view in the night where we can see all these are the cable stays, which are connecting the decking, right? This is a composite deck, right? Therefore, from the pylon, all these cables are connected to this composite decking. That of the same, another view of this Bandra Varli Sea Link, showing the cable stays connected to the decking, right? Now this is another example, which is a Chenab bridge. This is the world's highest railway bridge, which is under construction by Indian Railways, which is constructed, and this is called the Chenab Arch Bridge. Even you can see that it is 1.315 kilometer long. It is 1.315 kilometer long, and the even we know the Eiffel Tower is the tallest structure of the steel structure so far, right? Which is of around 324 meters above the ground level. But however, this arch, Chenab Arch Bridge, is surpassing its height, right? Now we are constructing at a height of 359 meters, which is more than 35 meters compared to that of this Eiffel Tower, right? Paris Eiffel Tower, right? Therefore, this is almost, this construction is happening above the river bed level at a level of 359 meters. Hence, this is the world's highest railway bridge by Indian Railways, right? Now, another schematic 3D view of the same Chenab Bridge, right? The arch is supported at the ends on the massive concrete blocks. Therefore, the entire load is transferred onto this massive concrete block into the hard strata into which it is embedded, right? That is how the arch bridge, Chenab Arch Bridge, right? Even we can see there are the vertical columns supporting this decking part, right? And the same Chenab Bridge now under construction. Now we can see that now crown part is under construction. That is how you can see almost they are at 330 meters above the river bed. Now the people are working, the men at work. That is the beauty of the civil engineering. Right? Then let us see, if you understood these discussions, students, then now this is how just now we have discussed that cable suspension bridges can be constructed using these steel as a material, right? These cables and which are called suspenders will be under tension. Even this cable which is supporting all these suspenders will also be under tension, this is also under tension. That once we see these discussions, even I'll refer to another cable suspension bridge which is constructed in China. Almost we can see that there on either side of the pylon, the span is almost 700 meter on either side, right? There is almost approximately 1.4 kilometer. That is the world's longest cable suspension bridge constructed in China, right? Even just now we have seen this Bandra Warla bridge, cable suspension bridge in Mumbai. Now, if you understood these, why the steel structures are needed, I think these establishes why steel structures are needed, right? Where other sections cannot furnish the section or section modulus or moment of inertia, then steel is an answer, right? Now, if you understood that, now let us move to the next discussion, students, right? That is, what are the advantages in such a case? What are the advantages of these steel material when used as a material? What is the advantage, right? Now then we can say that the characteristic compressive strength, right, or sorry, the characteristic strength or yield strength, FY, characteristic strength or yield strength or yield stress is high for steel sections, right? If the yield stress is more, then almost we can say that it can take more load. More the stress, yield stress, more load it can take for lesser or smaller thicknesses. Right? Therefore, less volume of the material is required. If that is the case, less volume of the material is required. Therefore, less weight or less tonnage of the steel is required. Less tonnage of the steel is required to take the same load. Otherwise, which need to be taken by a bulkier RCC sections or otherwise other sections, right? Now, that is an advantage, student. The next, the other advantages are the steel is a ductile material. This is so ductile, right? Therefore, it gives sufficient warning before before failure. It gives the deflections which are visible before failure. Therefore, it is a ductile material. It is a ductile material. There is advantage. Whereas pure RCC is on its own itself is not ductile. That is made ductile by insertion of the steel as reinforcing material there. Right? There also we will be using the steel in RCC. Right? Now next one is in addition to more strength, the steel is a tough material, right? It is a tough material, student. Right? That is it's a toughness. The more the toughness, even the more strength also, right? And the steel structures are light in weight because their thicknesses are very small. Therefore, they are light in weight when compared to that of the RCC. RCC bulkier sections like this, right? RCC section. Let us say if I take a beam of that of the RCC, that is a very bulkier, massive section. Compared to that, I do have very slim, right? Maybe slim sections like this, hardly small thicknesses, maybe 6 to 7, 8 or 10, 12 mm. That's it, right? Therefore, there is a reduction in the self-weight also, right? Leading to the economy. And the other advantage is that these sections can be prefabricated elsewhere and brought to the site, and they can be easily erected. Now, just now I have shown this photograph, right? You can see that all these trusses of this arch bridge are prefabricated elsewhere, and they are just bringing and erecting here. You can see just right each of the triangle. Now you can see that erecting one triangle of this arch bridge, right? That is a advantage. It can be prefabricated elsewhere and they can be brought and they can be erected at the site. Now coming to that of the other advantage, students, right? We can say that they are easy to handle because their sections are lightweight. They are easy to handle because their sections are lightweight. And if they are properly maintained, their lifespan is also very comparable when compared to that of the other structures. Even its lifespan increases. Right, and the properties of the steel doesn't change with the time because it is a homogeneous material when compared to that of the RCC. It is an heterogeneous material because their concrete, cement, right, aggregates, coarse aggregate, fine aggregate, right, water, chemical admixtures, etc., there along with the steel. Therefore, that is purely speaking, that is a heterogeneous material, but it is presumed to be equivalent homogeneous material. But here, steel is purely a homogeneous material, right? Therefore, its behavior will not change throughout the lifespan till failure, right? Then, and its properties will not change with the time also, right? And the another advantage is that we can make alterations at any given point of time, right? Like this. Just now we have seen, right? Let us say in this arch bridge, if because of some or other reason, if a particular section has deteriorated, then we can remove that part and it can be replaced. It can be replaced, right? That is how the advantage, right? Or we can say that the section can be removed and it can be replaced with another new one. Or in due course of the time, if at all more movements or more shear forces are expected, then what we can do is we can strengthen that part. Even let us say if I take a girder, then I can strengthen, let us say, a girder of span L, right? Generally, if it is simply supported, then WL square by 8. If W has doubled in due course of time, then obviously WL square by 8, right? W has increased by twice, means the bending moment will also increase by twice. But initially, we might have designed only for resisting just M. Now, The required moment of resistance is 2m. Therefore, in such a case, what we can do? Let us say if you already designed that as a girder section, then what you can do is you can add plates, right? Two or three more plates or other sections in the compression as well as tension zone. If at all it is a girder section, so that the moment of resistance increases. The moment of resistance increases, right? That is how the advantage. We can always strengthen. We can increase the shear resistance as well as the bending resistance of the steel section. Now the other advantages are like this, student, right? The structures can be given for position within short time, within just say 1 week to within 1 month, or just very small time we can give the position of such structures, right? Now whereas the other advantages are that if at all there are floods and other such exigencies, then temporary structures can be built using steel in short period, right? Temporary structures can be built using can be erected using the steel, using steel. There we can't have RCC structures there, right? Now and whereas even we can see that once these temporary structures have served their purposes, even we can de-erect such structures and they can be taken for reuse at another site of such requirement. That is also another advantage, that the de-erection can be done and the same truss or the same structure or same components of the structure can be reused elsewhere without changing the geometry. It can be used elsewhere for reuse. Therefore, such structures, steel structures, can be reused. Therefore, that is the prime advantage. Whereas in RCC, we cannot reuse. Once I dismantle that RCC structure, I cannot reuse that structure, right? And the other advantages are like this, that steel is having high scrap value. Let us say I have already used it so many times. Now, then I want to sell it. Therefore, if I want to sell, then I'll get a high scrap value for such steel. Even I'll get almost to say 60-70% of the initial value. However, if I sell the dismantled RCC debris, even I won't get more than say 0.12, hardly not more than 1% of the cost also I'll not get, right? That is how the disadvantage of other material, whereas this is the advantage of the steel, right? And even the other advantage that all these scraps can be melted and they can be refabricated as a new structural steel, recycled structural steel, right? That is also another advantage, right? However, once you understood the advantage, students, let us see the disadvantage also, right? The disadvantage, right? Even the structures, steel structures, are generally designed for a lifespan of 50 years, lifespan period, students. But however, these steel sections are prone for corrosion, right? These are prone for environmental attacks, because if at all these are there in the open environment, the environment can act on these components, which are very thin, and the components may be corroded in due course of time. Therefore, in order to avoid such corrosion, we need to do regular painting at a regular interval of maybe 1 to 2 years, keeping in with the requirement. Therefore, that requires additional cost of the maintenance, right, at regular intervals of 1 to 2 years. And even sometimes we need to have the painting for the fireproofing also. Fireproofing is also required, fireproofing painting, right? Whereas for RCC, such fireproofing painting is not required. There we do have at least a clear cover of 20 mm even for the slab, or even 30 to 40 mm up to the columns. Therefore, there the concrete is better compared to that of the steel structures, right, when exposed to fire. Now in this context, now I'll show the example of the failure of the WTO towers, right? WTO towers. This is the World Trade Center Twin Towers located in New York City, USA, the great USA. However, it was under attack on September 11, 2001 by the terrorists, right? Therefore, there we can see that the planes were hijacked and they were crashed into these towers, right? Leading to, that is how the crashing of the planes, right? Almost, this was having a plan dimension of approximately 60 meter by 60 meter square, right? This is a tubular framed structure built with steel and concrete decking, right? However, due to the impact force as well as the fire that engulfed after that attack, almost the steel columns started buckling. They started buckling, right? Almost after, say, 60 minutes to approximately after 100 minutes, all the columns at that story levels, maybe in 90 to 98 story levels, in one tower and almost in another tower, say approximately 70 to 80 tower, 80 floor levels, right? All the columns buckled, right? At the loss strength due to the buckling, because they are now under the fire. They were under fire. That is how the steel will lose the strength. Steel will lose the strength once it is exposed to fire. That is another prime disadvantage, right? Then the another disadvantage is that the steel is a good conductor of heat. Therefore, if at all you are constructing a steel structure for storing such materials such as ballistic materials or explosive materials, then this steel being a good conductor, almost that is not acceptable, right? Therefore, such explosive materials will explode if you store in such steel structures, right? That is not acceptable. And another advantage is the disadvantage is that under reversal of stresses, right, means under reversal means compression becoming tension, tension becoming compression. That is what called reversal of stresses cases, right? The steel will be losing the strength, right? That is because of the fatigue, right? Therefore, it will lose the strength. The decrease in the strength due to reversal of stresses is this phenomena is what referred to as a fatigue, right? Almost after say so many billions or millions of the cycles of the application of the load, compression becoming tension, tension becoming compression, right? The cyclic loading, right? Cyclic loadings, the strength will be lost. However, even in RCC and PSC also, the fatigue loads will reduce the strength, but compared to that of this steel, they are better because RCC is having a bulkier section, therefore it is somewhat better compared to that of these steel sections, which are generally very slim sections, very thin sections, right? Now, once you understood these discussions, student, let us move. What are the codes and codal specifications that we'll be referring, right? Therefore, in these all the discussions, I'll be referring IS 800 2007, Indian Standard General Construction in Steel Code of Practice, as well as SP61 1964, which is the Indian Standard Handbook for Structural Engineers. The first part, structural steel sections, right? That is how we'll refer to these two codes continually for all the designs during entire discussions. For all the designs, we'll be continually referring to these two Indian standard codes, right? Now let us see then what are the different Indian standard sections that are available, right? Now, this is how The next subheading, the Indian standard sections are called rolled steel sections, referred to as rolled steel sections. However, they may be hot rolled steel sections or they may be cold rolled sections. However, the hot rolled steel sections are generally manufactured from hot rolled mills when the steel is in hot molten stage, right? They are now put in the dies of the required shape. Then once the molten steel hardens, it gives the required shape like this, the required shape, maybe angle or as appropriate. Therefore, such sections are what referred to as hot rolled steel sections, or sometimes we may also be using the cold rolled steel sections, right? There, this is how the cold rolled sections are generally used for light gauge steel sections, right? Hardly their thicknesses may be varying from 2 to 3 mm, right? They are manufactured from the steel plates under the cold condition or under the rolling of the existing hot rolled steel plates. If I roll the hot rolled steel plates under cold conditions, then I'll get the small thicknesses, just required small thicknesses like this, right? That are this cold rolled steel section by rolling the hot rolled steel sections. And the hot rolled steel sections, their thicknesses may be varying from some 5 to 7 mm or 12 to 13 mm, but however the cold rolled steel sections, their thicknesses are in the range of 2 to 3 mm, right? Or 1 to 3 mm, right? Now I'll show the different sections at a quicker pace, then I'll move to SP6, right? This is how the Indian standard beam sections, right? Now, however, the before I go to the section students, let me discuss the materials and their specifications. I'll come to the sections, right? Let me discuss what are the materials and their specifications. Right now, I do have the types of the structural steels as per this page number 13 of IS 800 2007 code. Now I'll just move to that. Right there, we do have the steel grades like this. Right now, one moment. There, the steel sections, structural steel sections are defined. Structural steel sections are defined, right? Like this, right? That is conforming to Indian standard IS 2062, right? This is the table, student. I'll go back to the table, right? This table, table 1, tensile properties of structural steel products. As per Indian standards, right, we do have IS 513, right, the different grades, right, IS 814, the different grades of the or classifications of the steel, and IS 1079, the different grades or specifications, and IS 1367 part 3, right, these are actually confirming to IS 1367 means that of the bolts. We'll see that later, right, bolts, right. And IS 1875, different grades, right? IS 1990, right? Different grades, and IS 2002, the different specifications. Now coming to this, IS 2062, right? Different grades and specifications. IS 3039, IS 6240, right? And IS 7557, IS 9295, IS 10,748. These are different IS codes are referred for the grades and as well as their yield stresses and ultimate stresses along with the elongations. Now let us come to this IS 2062. Generally we'll be using these as a structural steels, right? There What is that grade specification? How it is referred? Now I'll show like this, right? There, as per this, we do have the specification like this: FE 290. FE stands for ferrous. 290 stands for ultimate stress. Ultimate stress, right? Whereas its yield stress is 165 MPa, Newton per mm square. Newton per mm square. Now let us examine that. FE 290. This is how the grade, right? FE 290, with the first grade, or which is referred classification, or the grade is referred to as E165. That 165 stands for the yield stress, whereas 290 stands for ultimate tensile stress, minimum value in MPa, Newton per mm square, and its elongation, in any case, should not be less than 23%. Likewise, even I do have the other grades, E250 grade, having three classifications: FE410W, A, B, and C. Three classifications, right? For which all of these, the yield stress, if at all the diameter or the thickness or the dimension is less than 20 mm for 410W, A, the yield stress is 250, whereas for dimensions or the thickness or the diameter is in the range of 20 to 40, then the yield stress is 240, whereas if the dimension is greater than 40 mm, then the yield stress is taken as 230 for E250 grade steel or FE410W A grade, A's classification, right? That will be having ultimate tensile stress of 410 MPa and the elongation shall not be less than 23 for all the three, right? Now let us see what is this A, B, and C respectively, students, right? Where that A stands for structural components intended for normal use, and this B classification is if the structures which are subjected to non-critical applications where temperature variation T2 minus T1 is not less than 0 degree, then B classification, whereas the C classification will come into picture if temperature variation is not exceeding minus 40 degree centigrade, right? That is how these A, B, C stands, right? Therefore, that is how we do have FE410 grade steel, right? Likewise, FE440, FE490, FE540, 570D, 580, 590E, different grades of the steels are available. As per this, IS 800. Now, even we do have FE440, FE490, FE540, FE570D, FE590E classifications are the grades, respectively starting from E165 to E450, where yield stress itself is 450 or it may be 430 or 420, keeping in with the dimension of the material, where the ultimate stress of this FE590E classification is 590 MPa, and the elongation is 20%, right? Once we see these classifications, let us move to the other discussions on chemical composition of steel. What is the chemical composition of the structural steel, like this, right? Then let us see the type of steel, standard steel. Generally, this FE410A, B, C grades are referred to as the standard structural steels, right? Conforming to IS 2062, there the carbon, maximum carbon is 0.23 carbon, right? Percentage, right? And manganese maximum is 1.5%, right? And sulfur 0.05. Whereas the phosphorus maximum is 0.05%, and the silicon is 0.4%, whereas its carbon equivalent, which is notated by SK, its carbon equivalent is 0.42 for Fe410A grade. Right? Likewise, for Fe410B grade, these are respectively 0.22, 1.5, 0.045, 0.045, 0.4. Carbon equivalent is SK 0.41. Whereas for Fe410C grade, these are respectively 0.2, 1.5, 0.04, 0.04, 0.4. Whereas the carbon equivalent is K 0.39, right? Now we can see that the more ductility wherever it is required, more ductility wherever there is a ductility demand, wherever there is a ductility demand in case of where the temperature changes from positive to negative temperatures, then there is a great demand for the ductility. There is a great demand for the ductility. Therefore, now we'll see how the ductility will be impacted using this carbon equivalent, right? Now, here in this carbon equivalent notation, student, what is SK and K, where SK is referred to as semi-killed and K is called killed, right? Then, once we see this standard structural steel of Fe410ABC grades, now we'll move to the medium Fe440 and Fe490 medium structural steels, right, are the high structural steels or high strength structural steels of Fe540, 570, 590 grades, as just now we have seen from this IS 800, right? Then, however, we can note now that more is the carbon content, less is the ductility of the structural steel, right? However, more is the carbon content, the strength increases as well as the toughness increases, right? That is all. The carbon content, more is the carbon content, less is the ductility. However, strength is more. More the carbon content, more the strength, right? Now, let us see the chemical composition for this medium as well as high strength structural steels, right? For the medium, right? This is what called microalloyed medium structural steel, Fe440, right? Confirming to this code IS 8500, right? There the different chemical compositions are like this, right? The carbon 0.2, the manganese 1.3, sulfur 0.05, phosphorus 0.05, silicon 0.45, and carbon equivalent is 0.4. whereas for high strength steel confirming to same IS 8500 of classification Fe540 and Fe590 respectively, these are respectively, say, like this: 0.2, 1.6, 0.045, 0.045, 0.45, and carbon equivalent is 0.44. and for Fe590, these are respectively the specifications, right, are the metallurgical components, actually, right? The specifications are like this: the carbon is maximum is 0.22, and manganese 1.8, and sulfur 0.045, and phosphorus 0.045, silicon maximum is 0.45, and carbon equivalent is 0.48, right? That is how we can see that as the carbon content increases, the strength of the structural steel increases, but at the same time the ductility decreases. Even you can see that there's an increase in carbon content leading to increase in ultimate load or increasing the strength, but loss of the ductility by some extent, by some amount, right? I think, student, you understood that. Now, once we see that, now let us move to the next subheading as the stress strain curve for mild steel. Stress strain curve for the mild steel, right? And this is how the stress versus strain, or this is on y-axis load, on the x-axis deformations, or load divided by area is stress, and that deformation divided by its initial length is the strain or percentage elongation, right? Now let us see, this we already discussed at a graduate level in strength of material. Even you have connected experiments on the mild steel tension test in at bachelor's level in engineering mechanics lab or strength of material lab or material testing lab under tension test, right? This is how the stress strain characteristics of a mild steel rod under tension test, right? Like this, right? Therefore, we can see that as the load increases, we have started the load at zero load, then there is no deformation, there is no initial strain in this case, right? Whereas as the load increases, the deformations also increases up to a particular limit. That limit is what called the proportional limit, student, right? That is how, at which the percentage elongation is around 0.1%, right? And further increase in load will happen leading to the further increase in the deformations, right? Once we reach a particular point which is called the elastic point or elastic limit, right? Therefore, till elastic limit, whatever the loads are applied, after relieving the loads, the structure will regain its original shape. But beyond elastic limit, there will be a permanent set like that. Even after leaving the load, there will be a permanent set like this, right? Therefore, that is how the elastic limit given by the salient point E, right? And once we cross that elastic limit, then we'll be having the upper yield point, right? And also the lower yield point. Sometimes these yield points may be seen or may not be seen for some specimens, right? That is almost we do have the lower yield point at which the percentage elongation is 1% compared to that of this elastic proportional limit, where the percentage elongation was 0.1. Now almost this is 10 times more, right? Now once we reach the lower yield point, right? Lower yield point, as load go on increasing, there is no increment noted in the load, but the deformations are happening tremendously, more and more deformations are happening, right? Therefore, that is how this part is what called the strain hardening part, right? This is the end of the strain hardening part notated by SHP, right? At which the percent elongation is 1.5%, right? Once the strain hardening part is over, under that constant load, more deformations have happened, right? Then the steel rod can further take further loads, right? That is how slowly as the load increases, the deformations also increases up to ultimate point, right? Up to ultimate load. Corresponding to this ultimate point, the load is what called ultimate load. And beyond ultimate load, now necking will form like this, right? You can see that necking is forming, right? Like this before failure, right? Previously it was a solid section like this. Now necking has formed, right? Leading to failure of this, or breaking of this specimen. That is what called the break point. Therefore, at which the elongations are almost 25%. Accordingly, these points are what called the proportional point or elastic point, upper yield point, lower yield point, the strain hardening point, or ultimate load point and breaking point, right? Then which you are already aware of, because you already conducted experiments in strength of material lab also to note down the different salient points, right? We'll discuss the other discussions in the next class, such as the other properties as per this IS 800 as well as IS SP 61 in the next class, students, right? I hope you understood these discussions, right? If you like these discussions on our YouTube, you try to click like, share, subscribe to our YouTube channel, as well as turn on the video notifications, and as well as comment, right? We'll meet with another discussion in the next class, students. Till then, bye bye, students.